This is Eric Senich from the Van Halen News Desk. We have author and rock and roll historian Susan Messina with us. She's been a rock journalist for over 30 years. She appeared in the Van Halen DVD, The Early Years, from 2003, and shared her story meeting and hanging out with the guys in Van Halen back in 1978 with the Van Halen News Desk back in 2018. Susan also has a fascinating background in the paranormal, and that ties in a little bit of what we'll talk about in this interview. So let's get to it. Susan, thanks so much for joining us to share your memories of Eddie Van Halen.
Thank you, Eric. Thank you for having me.
You know, I wish we could be meeting under better circumstances. Sadly, we lost Eddie Van Halen, of course, and Van Halen fans, myself included, are still coming to terms with the reality that he's no longer with us. And before I get your thoughts on his passing, if you could just remind the fans of your connection to Van Halen and Eddie. The first time you met the band was back in 1978. What an experience that was, so much so that it even got a mention in the band's second album, Liner Notes. If you could talk about that a little bit, your history with Eddie and the band Van Halen.
Yeah, I was lucky to write for a local paper at the time that their first album came out. And I met the band on the fourth night of their first tour with Montrose and Journey. They played the Shuffle Inn, a club in Madison, Wisconsin, on March 7th, 1978. And that was also the second of the three nights that they trashed the seventh floor of the Sheraton Hotel.
The Roth Room.
Yeah. Now, how many 43 years later, 42 years later, I was up in Wisconsin. I live in Savannah now, but I was up in Wisconsin for the weekend of my birthday, which is October 3rd. And on the 2nd, I was at the Sheraton Hotel. We had a book signing, a birthday party, very small, people wore masks, but they unveiled, the Sheraton Hotel in Madison unveiled the Roth Room, which is a conference room on the 7th floor, where they had a lot of fun up there back in 78, and they have a ton of really cool things, you know, everything from tickets to guitar picks, photos, articles from the time, because the paper I worked for ended up being the first paper in the United States to put Van Halen on the cover.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So we were also celebrating that. Yeah, Warner Brothers just loved us to death.
Sure. And that's why they call it the Roth Room. Now, that's the room you were in with the band, too? You were hanging out with the guys?
Well, they took some of the rooms that they stayed in and made that into like a conference room. That's called the Roth Room now. But at some point, they're going to take all the artwork and all the framed articles and put them on the outside of the room in the hallway so all the guests can see it, not just people that use the conference room. But the funny part is when I first went up there to see it, which is beautiful. They did. I have a ton of pictures I can send you, and they did a beautiful job. But they called it the Roth Room. And as soon as I walked in the door, and this was on October 2nd, the first thing, I just blurted out, "Oh my God, Eddie and Alex are going to hate this." I know they all looked at me like, "What?" And I'm sorry, but it kind of should be called the Van Halen Room.
Sure.
So that's my humble opinion. It's got a good sound to it, but it should be the Van Halen Room.
Absolutely. And anyone who wants to get the full story, Susan gave the VHND an exclusive a few years back, telling the story in detail of what happened that night. You were also interviewed for the Inside magazine before that, and then for Van Halen News Desk, it was like an updated version of it. So it's just a great story, and I'll put the link up for people to see. So many have already read it, but it's great to go back and read it again. And you did give us some photos, too. I'm looking at them here. And you got to tell the story of Eddie, because it looks like he's got his hand somewhere where it shouldn't be, right?
He does, yes. I always got to take a picture with the band because if I was there and we had our photographer there, he would do a cover shot and then he would say, "Jump in, we'll snap a pic," you know? And they were a little rowdy, I'm going to say. They're a little rowdy. They're a little intimidating to me. And I didn't want to take a picture with them. And I kept saying, "No, it's okay. That's okay." And pretty soon the band, they started to make fun of it. And they started to fake cry. And they're like, "Oh, we're not good enough to take a picture with." And I'm like, "Oh, stop it." And I walked up and I looked at all of them. And I said, "All right, don't touch me. If you touch me, picture's over." And I turned around, I crossed my arms, and that was it. And I could feel David's fingers on my elbow, very gently. Michael was behind me, and Alex leaned in so I could feel his hair on my neck. But Eddie bent down, and I thought, and everybody started to laugh. They're giggling. Even the photographer was giggling, and I'm thinking, what's so funny? I'm thinking he's trying to get in the picture, you know? And I had these, you know, it was the 70s, for gosh sake. I had these wide leg dress pants on. And he bent down, and he put his hands around my thigh. But I never felt a thing, because if I would have felt it, I would have hit the ceiling. But when the picture came back 2 days later, the photographer walked up to me at our offices, and he says, you want to know why everybody was giggling so hard? And I said, yeah, why? And he handed me that picture. And it does look like Eddie Van Halen has both hands where he shouldn't be.
It does. I'm looking at it as you're telling me this story, so that makes it even more fun to hear. And Michael Anthony's got a devilish grin. Look at the look on his face standing behind you.
And he's wearing his Bad City t-shirt. They went shopping on State Street. That's where he got that.
Oh, boy. And you got a chance to see these guys perform. That was quite an experience.
Oh, incredible. I mean, there were so many. There's about maybe a 700 capacity at this club. There had to have been 1,000 people in there that night. And where you stood, I got about maybe 10 feet in front of the stage. Where you stood, that was it. You couldn't move. Once they started to play and they played their whole first album, you couldn't get a drink. You couldn't move to go to the restroom. That was it. It was like sardines, but it was amazing. And at the end, David grabbed a couple bottles of champagne and shook them up and sprayed the crowd. And, you know, it was quite the party.
Now, you knew when you were watching, like, this is something special? I mean, this is going to be a band that's going to go places?
Oh, God, yes. Everybody did. I mean, even the band. The band was hilarious. It was like, I think I said that in the early years DVD, you know, it was like they knew in about 10 minutes they were going to be internationally famous.
And just a word or two on each of the guys. I want to start with Eddie, though, because obviously that's who we're remembering. Your first thoughts when you met Eddie, what do you remember?
Well, I thought he was gorgeous, for one thing. Had an incredibly huge crush on him. He was sitting on the couch in the basement of the Shuffle, which was like your dad's old rec room, you know, with trophies on the wall and all that, shag carpet, you know, and he's just sitting on the couch, you know, playing his guitar. He's got a little practice amp, and he was very, very sweet, very quiet. We're just chatting, you know, just talking, and he asked everybody, he says, you want to hear the first song I ever learned on the guitar? And sure, you know, so he played Pipeline for us, and he was amazing. He's a lot like Angus Young in a way. He's super quiet, and then you get on stage, and it's like a bomb going off, you know? He was so sweet, and when we partied after the show that night, he did go to his own room and stay in his own room, and Alex dragged me along, and we tried to talk him into coming over to the next room to the party, but he wouldn't do it. He was very shy, actually.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you hear. Yeah, he was unassuming, right? Didn't think of himself as a big deal. He certainly wasn't comfortable with the rock god, guitar god label.
Well, no, and I heard the night before that, you know, they got the cops called so many times to the Sheridan that they just put a patrol car in the parking lot. And the night before, Eddie got thrown out into the hallway and locked out when the cops got there. So he wasn't real happy with Alex. Alex did that to him.
Yeah. Him and Alex had the legendary brotherly battles. And then 5 minutes later, everything's fine. You know, people would tell stories like that they'd be literally on the ground wrestling and going at it. And then 5 minutes later, everything's cool.
No, Eddie was just such a sweetheart. And I have, I should send you a picture. I don't know if I have a picture of this, but he signed my paper. It came out 2 weeks later. And we took the bundles of papers down to Schaumburg, Illinois, to the club Beginnings. Van Halen was playing the Loop's birthday party. That was a big radio station at the time. And we took papers there, and I had him autograph a copy. And I have an autograph of Eddie that says, Sue, I love your thighs, Eddie Van Halen.
That's great. That's great.
Yeah, that's priceless.
Yeah, going mad in Wisconsin, Van Halen destroys 7th floor of the Sheraton Inn, if people want to Google it. But again, I'll put the link up. All right, next is Alex.
I loved Alex. Alex and I were a lot alike, I found out. He was funny. He was always trying to cause trouble. He was probably the loudest of the four as far as causing trouble. But he was a lot of fun. I mean, we had a blast. He actually, you can read about this, he taught me how to smash my head in an elevator door, which I do not recommend to anyone to do. But he thought that was hilarious, and he was just great fun. I love Alex.
How to slam your head in an elevator door?
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah, it was not my choice. It was Alex did it first, and then he threw me out in the hallway and said, "You're going to do it, or we're not going anywhere."
Oh, my
and
God.
That, yeah, I didn't really have a choice.
Michael Anthony.
He was the sweetest of the four. He was so polite, very, very quiet, soft-spoken until he got on stage again, but probably the nicest of the four. Very sweet and very respectful. I didn't see him cause a lot of trouble. I think he laughed a lot. He had a smile on his face a lot, but it was more Alex and David were the two.
And now, last but not least, Diamond Dave.
I love Dave. I really do. He is an amazing person. He can talk about anything forever, is what I found very interesting. He was a lot smarter than I thought he was when, you know, I just saw his pictures, so what I imagined. But when I met David, I had a crush on Eddie. Okay, I'm just going to say it. I had a crush on Eddie. I thought David was gorgeous, but he wasn't my type of guy. So I didn't act all like, ooh, you know, and he picked up on that right away. He loved that I wasn't like fawning all over him. And I wasn't. I was like, hey, Dave, you know, what's up? And and I like to tell the story about how there was only one bathroom in the basement dressing room. And as they got ready to go on that night, everybody took turns going to the bathroom, except for David, who changed into his leather pants in front of me. Now, he didn't ask me to turn around, and I didn't offer. So,
that is great.
And then I watched him on stage, and then I watched him crush people at the party, girls that were all over him. He was not very polite to some of them. And Alex was the one that made me watch that, because Al was all about, you know, like, okay, watch this, watch David. You got to watch what he's going to do. So that's what we did. We were David watching. But when they came around about a year later and opened for Black Sabbath, my ex-husband and I think he was my boyfriend at the time, but at the time we were backstage with Van Halen, and we spent the whole set of Black Sabbath sitting in the dressing room talking to David. I love David. He's an amazing person. So the guy has been around the block, and Diamond Dave, there'll never be another one, just like Eddie. I mean, losing Eddie is... it's a huge, huge loss for everybody.
Hard to believe. When did you find out he passed, and what was your initial reaction when you found out?
Well, on the 4th of October, I checked out of the Sheraton. And as I was driving away, Jump came on the radio. And I had a little giggle at that. And I just thought, well, I hope you guys enjoy your tribute floor. And then 2 days later, I woke up and picked up my phone, and I saw that Eddie had passed, and, you know, I still cry over it. He was a huge part of my history, one of the greatest guitar players to ever live, basically, and a genius. I was lucky. I met a genius, and he was only 23. So sad, really, really sad, because we're almost the same age, and he was always one of my touchstones of, like, when you feel like, oh my God, I'm too old for this, or I shouldn't be doing this anymore. And then I'd look at Eddie and think, Eddie's still doing it.
Yeah.
You know, what?
Exactly.
He's older. He's a little bit older than you. So he was a touchstone for me. And to have him gone now, it's horrible. It's sad.
You know, I was thinking today, I'm thinking, boy, you know, actually, I was listening to the new David Lee Roth song. And, I thought that excitement of hearing a new song from Dave or from Sammy. But the ultimate was when you found out there was a new Van Halen album and tour, you know, and that was that excitement. Oh, and then I thought, boy, you know, that's never going to happen again. You know, and that 2012, when A Different Kind of Truth came out, I felt like I was a kid again. And,
Yeah.
I mean, I cherish that and I'm grateful for it. But on the other side of it, it's like, boy, you're never going to feel that again.
No, I know. I feel the same way. I was up in Wisconsin until the... God, I can't remember, the 16th of October. And I was super busy, you know, with a lot of different things. And it is slowly, like every day, it kind of hits you a little bit harder.
Sure.
Of like, he's gone, you know, and too young, way too young. he battled for so long, and to keep that quiet and to keep his dignity and you know, his humanity and his compassion for other people, it just shows you what an incredibly beautiful person he was.
Gene Simmons, did you hear the story he told about Eddie?
Yeah, I did. I did.
Yeah.
And so sweet. I've read just about everything that's come out, and it's heartbreaking. We should have had him for at least another 20 years.
I know. For those that may not know, Gene Simmons, the story was he ran into him, I think, shortly after he had the piece of his tongue removed. And he just didn't feel sorry for himself. He didn't complain. He was just like, hey, man, I got cancer. That's, you know, what are you going to do? And Gene was kind of taken aback by it. Like, he didn't know what to say because he thought it might be uncomfortable. And Eddie just it was like, hey, man, it is what it is. You know, let's move on. And that was it. I wanted to ask before I forget, after 78, how many times did you see the band again? Did you get to cover them a lot after that?
I did. I covered them on and off. The last time that the last time I saw them was in 2013, and that was the reunion tour with David, and it wasn't a great venue. It was outside, and they were way, way far away, like a football field away from me. So that wasn't the greatest experience, but the closest that I got to them after 78, because I saw them, you know, when they'd come on tour, absolutely. But I got to see them at Alpine Valley when Sammy was now in the band in 91, I think, when Alice in Chains opened for them. And that was a really fun show. And, you know, Sammy did a great job picking up and all the new music that they made together. But Van Halen will always be Van Halen with David to me.
Yeah.
That's just kind of where I'm at on it.
Well, I always say, you know, I think it's a lot of it has to do with when you were born, your age. So I was in high school in the late 80s and connected with the Sammy era. So I have a lot of great memories connected to those years. So it's different. If I was born 10 years earlier, I certainly could understand how it would be very, very hard to accept. For me, it was my introduction to them. And then I worked back through the Dave years and became a huge fan, but certainly can understand that. Do you have a favorite Van Halen song if you had to pick one?
Probably Running with the Devil.
Classic.
Yeah. Yeah, well, and that was their, you know, the record company insisted on putting You Really Got Me out as a single, which was a cover song, as we all know. But they had so much of their own stuff that when they released Running with the Devil, I think that's what, I mean, they were already up there, but that's what blew everything off, was once Running with the Devil came out, then it's like, okay, this is a whole different monster here.
Absolutely. That album is absolutely perfect. There's not one thing about it you could say, yeah, I wish they did it different. It's funny because Eddie says Eruption. There's a mistake in Eruption. And, you know, it's like, okay, good luck trying to find it. I don't think anybody can hear it, but he, you know, he's the one who could hear it. So crazy.
Yeah, try to pinpoint that, you know. It's because when we, at the paper, we got a album in the mail, a red one, with four songs on it. And the first song was Eruption. When we put it on the turntable at the paper that I worked at, that was insane. Put that needle down and listen to Eruption, and we were all looking at each other going, what the hell is this? I wrote this in my first book, and I couldn't remember it during the filming of the early years, and this quote should have been in there, but at the point that I heard Van Halen, I had seen everybody live, you know, Black Sabbath, Pink Floyd, The Who, Deep Purple, everybody. When I heard the first couple of seconds of Van Halen on that turntable, it was like putting on a pair of rose-colored glasses. The world wasn't the same tint anymore.
I want to finish with a story that I heard you tell on the Beyond the Paranormal podcast last week, I think this was. So this blew me away, and I'm a big fan of that podcast. And you were on to talk about rock and roll and the paranormal, and I was so surprised to hear you tell this story. I think it's best before you tell it, just to give listeners an idea of your background in the paranormal. You have had paranormal experiences as far back as a child, correct?
Yes. Yeah, I've been fascinated with the paranormal my entire life, and I actually got into it, I'd say, more professionally a good 10 years ago, maybe 10 or 11 years ago now. I do speeches at paranormal conferences. I wrote a book called The Secrets of the Universe. And I've done investigations in Gettysburg, you know, Bobby Mackey's, Deadwood, South Dakota, And I love the paranormal. Rock and roll and the paranormal interweave a lot.
This one just blew me away. This involves Eddie just a few nights before he passed. He passed on October 6th. So this is in the same place that you hung with Eddie and the band back in 1978, right? That's where this story...
Yes, it is.
Okay, if you could just tell this story, because I was just blown away when I heard it.
Okay, well, you know, I was there with three girlfriends. We had two rooms on the seventh floor. And two of my girlfriends are psychic mediums, hypnotherapists, Reiki masters. And they're the ones that I've done a lot of my investigations with. So they were in one room, and myself and my other girlfriend were in our own room. And we were talking about that the hotel is haunted, and even the employees talked about that, especially the basement. But there's, you know, there's been a lot of rock and roll in that hotel. So the night of the 2nd, I did my book signing. And we were up pretty late, but we went to sleep, I was trying to go to sleep. And I was laying there, and I could not sleep. And I was all these things, all, you know, the nights that I had been at the Sheraton and how many things happened on the floor that I was literally staying on. And I could not sleep. And I'm laying there, and all of a sudden, somebody comes up to me and goes into my left ear and goes, just this big breath into my ear. It was so vivid, I could feel it on my skin. And I was irritated at that point. And I said in my own head, I just said, really? Oh, okay, that's great. Whoever you are, you need to leave or climb in and help me go to sleep. Your choice. I fell asleep. The next day, I told the girls about it. We were laughing. And I kept calling him Eddie, as in Eddie Money, because I had partied with Eddie Money and his band at the Sheraton, and Eddie Money had already passed. So I kept calling this guy Eddie. So the 2nd night, we were up really late because it was my birthday, and we had a lot of fun. We partied, picked up food and all of that. We're in bed. I'm trying to go to sleep. My girlfriend's out like a light. I'm laying there staring up at the ceiling as usual, and all of a sudden, my girlfriend, who's sound asleep, lets out a blood-curdling scream. And for about a half a second, I was ready to, like, hit the door so fast because I didn't know what she was screaming at. And she burst into laughter right after she screamed. And I looked over and I said, are you all right over there? And she's like, oh, my God, oh, my God. And I said, what happened to you? And she says, I'm laughing because I woke myself up screaming. And I said, well, what were you screaming at? And she goes, there's a guy in our room, and he shoved his face in my face and scared the hell out of me. And that's when I said, oh, that's Eddie. Eddie, would you knock it off? You know, leave us alone now. That's enough. And then 2 days later, Eddie Van Halen passed. I now know that Eddie was not Eddie Money. I think he did not like the room being called the Roth room, for one thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Dave's getting credit again. Yeah.
Exactly. And even before we went to bed that night, we were both in our room, and there was somebody in the bathroom making noise. And I looked at her, and I said, you heard that, right? And she goes, yeah. And I said, yeah, that's Eddie again. He's bugging us. I said, Eddie, knock it off. So I called him Eddie the whole weekend, thinking it was Eddie Money.
Wow.
So.
Dave's getting all the attention again. This is ridiculous. That's a wild story. Now, I had only heard recently of this happening with elderly people or people who are about to pass, that their soul is ready to move on. So it's kind of making the rounds, kind of saying their goodbyes. Mm-hmm. I mean, is that, because I know people hearing this right now are going to think, well, wait a minute. If he was still alive, how does that all work? What's the explanation behind that?
Well, I think as people are getting ready to transition, I think that they're able to do in the astral plane, they can do whatever they want. And before this happened, before the whole event, I got a hold of the Van Halen news desk. I got a hold of everybody I could get a hold of, hoping that one of the band members might respond to the unveiling of the Roth room. So I did put it out there that it was happening. Not that he was aware of it, but if he was on the astral plane and he was getting ready to transition and heard that there was a Roth room being unveiled at the 7th floor of the Sheraton, I think he showed up. I really do. Mm.
Well, it's a standout moment in their career and in his life too. So those are the type of places that he would probably want to go back and revisit.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And it's a great tribute to the whole band. I mean, once they put everything up in the hallway, you know, we told them they're going to have to secure them to the wall so people don't try to steal them.
So some will hear this story and not believe it. But, you know, there are those like myself who were open. I'm open to it. And I believe something like this can happen. And, you know, I do like what John Lennon once said. And I think they asked Lennon, this was shortly before he died, if he was afraid of death. And he said, it's like getting out of one car and into another, meaning that we continue on after this life ends, we go to into another vehicle. Would you agree? Is that the kind of the way to look at it in the simplest of terms?
Yes, absolutely. And I also like to add, which, you know, this is just a coincidence to me. It might not be to everybody, but somebody breathed into my left ear that night, and that was the side that Eddie was on when we took that picture.
Oh, yeah.
So I thought that was kind of interesting, too.
Yes, yes.
Somebody was right there.
Somebody was right there. Well, I hope for those who are believers that, you know, they hear your story and take some comfort in it, because one thing's for certain, Eddie's spirit, I mean, his spirit will be here, especially when you think about that creative energy that he had, that he put out there.
That's strong energy. And he feels the love. And my heart, my condolences go out to all his fans and his family, and especially to Wolfie. And Eddie feels the love. And I totally believe that he feels it. Mm. And he will always feel it.
All the beautiful things people are saying about Eddie, not just his talent, not just his guitar playing. Everybody knows about that. But one thing you've heard a lot is, well, a couple things. The smile. People always remember his smile. And people often are calling him a kind, gentle soul.
Exactly. And he was. He really was. He was a real sweetheart.
Yeah.
And all he ever did was smile and say nice things to me. So I will always remember him with a lot of love.
Very cool. SusanMassino.com, that's your website, right?
Yes.
Okay. And that's where people can find out more about Susan and her books, which includes Rock and Roll Fantasy, My Life and Times with AC/DC. Is that your brand new book?
That's my first book.
The
book that I'm currently promoting is an updated edition of the story of AC/DC, Let There Be Rock.
Gotcha. I knew it was an AC/DC book. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, because the rest of that title is, it's Rock and Roll Fantasy, My Life and Times with AC/DC, Van Halen, and Kiss. That's the full title,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Okay. So people can get it there.
Dot, dot, dot.
And there's more. Yeah.
Yep.
You share some great Van Halen stories in there as well. So people should definitely check it out. Susan, thank you so much.
Thank you. I mean, it's an honor. It was an honor and a privilege to meet them when I did, and to be included in the Van Halen DVD and all of that. It's been a real honor for me. So thank you so much.